So let's move to our next panel, which is extremely interesting, ladies and gentlemen, as we dive deep into East India's chai culture in association with Goodrick Tea. বাঙালির চা প্রীতি নিয়ে আর নতুন করে আপনাদের কি বলবো। চায়ের কাপে তুফান কথাটা এমনিতেই প্রচলিত আছে। অ্যাট দ্য সেম টাইম ঠিক এই মুহূর্তে দাঁড়িয়ে পশ্চিমবঙ্গে এই চায় কালচার ইজ ভেরি পপুলার। কেন? কারণ বিজেপি নেতা দিলীপ ঘোষ সকালবেলায় চা চক্র করতে শুরু করলেন এবং তার মানুষের কাছাকাছি পৌঁছে যাওয়ার এই একটা চরম রাস্তা তিনি বাছলেন এবং খুব সঠিকভাবে বাছলেন। তার কারণ হচ্ছে ছোট 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 জায়গা থেকে যে বিতর্ক, চায়ের ঠেকে আড্ডা, ঠেকে ঠেকে ঠোকাঠুকি যেটা শুরু হতো সেটা আস্তে 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 কীরকম রাজ্য পলিটিক্সের নানা বিষয় হয়ে উঠল। এই ফর্মুলাটাই অন্যরাও প্রয়োগ করতে শুরু করলেন, হয়তো চায় পে চর্চা বা চা চক্র নাম দিয়ে নয়, কিন্তু অলমোস্ট মোডাস অপারান্ডাইটা একই রকমভাবে। এই চা এ নিয়ে নানা রকমের ইতিহাস তো আছেই, নানা রকমের মিথ আছে এবং সেই মিথগুলোকে কেন্দ্র করে তার নানা রকমের ব্যাখ্যা আজও পর্যন্ত চলে। আমার বাড়িতে যখন অতিথি আসেন, ইফ দেয়ার্স আ গেস্ট ইন দ্য ফ্যামিলি, উই ইন্ডিয়ানস জেনারেলি উই ইনভাইট দেম উইথ এ কাপ অফ টি। কত রকমের চা, তার কত রকমের বিন্যাস। খুব রিসেন্টলি আমি একটা বেকিং ফেস্টিভ্যালে গিয়েছিলাম, আমি সেখানে গিয়ে দেখলাম একটা দুর্দান্ত চায়ের স্টল, মানে বেকিং ফেস্টিভ্যালটার থেকে বড় হয়ে উঠেছিল সেই চায়ের স্টলটা, বিকজ দে হ্যাভ ব্রট ইন সাম স্পেশাল ফ্লেভার্স। আমি যেহেতু এন্টারটেনমেন্ট ইন্ডাস্ট্রির সঙ্গে কাজ করি, আমি বলতে পারি আমাদের ইন্ডাস্ট্রিতে এমন অনেক চায় দাদারা আছেন, তারা নিজেদের মাথা খাটিয়ে ছোট ছোট উদ্যোগে এমন এমন ফ্লেভার্স নিয়ে আসেন যা কিনা দেশের তাবড় স্টার পলিটিশিয়ানদের ভীষণ প্রিয় হয়ে ওঠেন। এমনই একজন চা দাদা আছেন যার অরেঞ্জ ফ্লেভার চা, ম্যাঙ্গো ফ্লেভার চা, এগুলো সব নাকি অমিতাভ বচ্চনের ভীষণ রকমের প্রিয়। সো when we are actually looking deep down into our culture on this platform of Earth, a cultural fest, there was a time that we used to call it Earth, a culture quest. আমাদের খোঁজ থাকতো আমাদের সংস্কৃতির শিকরে। তো এবারে একটু চায়ের খোঁজে আমরা যাই, diving deep into East India's chai culture in association with Goodrick Tea. The panelists who are be here on the stage in a while is Abhijit Iyer Mitra. He's a senior fellow at the Institute of Peace and Conflict Studies. He specializes in defense economics and has been visiting fellow at Sandia National Laboratories at the Stimson Center and regularly publishes on defense and foreign policy. Bhishon bhabi chair onuragi tini. And also with us is Mr. Vinod Gurung. Mr. Gurung is the General Manager, Sales and Marketing, Goodrick Tea. And moderating this session is Shujay Prasad Chatterjee, who is a good friend, and he is hosting right from the beginning. Shujay, kotha ami notun kore ki bolbo ei arthen monche, he is one of the closest to us. Last year he was the MC, only this year also again he is hosting Earth for the second time. Ekjon versatile talent, jerokom bhabe bachik shilpi sherokom or obhinoyer khomota, politically aware, bhishon bhishon rokome porashonor shonge royeche. So you know he is a versatile talent and we are very proud to have Shujay Prasad Chatterjee as the moderator of this session.
Well, if you've brought a Bengali to talk about tea, I think there could be hours of discussion, but we don't have hours. But thank you very much for having me moderate this very stimulating adda And with us, we have two very interesting gentlemen, one who grows tea and one who develops a culture, the tea culture. Well, we begin the session by thanking Mr. Gurung, because this is a Goodrick panel. This panel is being presented by Goodrick Tea. And having grown into a family of lovers of tea, Goodrick has been a part of our heritage and tradition. And as I told you, I just recently went to rejuvenate myself after all the COVID and everything to the hills. I spent hours at the Margaret Deck sipping my favorite Castleton. On that note, I would like to ask you that what wine is to the French is what tea is to a Bengali. How do you look at the entire aspect of you know, the tea culture in the eastern part of this country in terms of your corporate vision?
Thank you very much for having me here. It's always a pleasure to talk about tea, especially in Kolkata, where we have the highest consumption of our Darjeeling teas.
Yes.
As you mentioned about like wine being very close to the French, even our teas is supposed to be as good. In fact, it's called the nectar of gods or the elixir of life. So it is something like a really, I mean, if you really go into deep, you can get so many flavors and there are so many tastes out of tea. So right. It's actually, I mean, you can say that it's a nectar, a nectar of the gods.
That's like beautiful. Yeah.
As far as our tea is concerned, our company's vision is concerned, we have focused on two issues. One is quality. Quality not only of the produce, which is tea, but also the quality of the people.
Right.
Who go into making teas, who mm-hmm. go in, who all of them who are associated with tea production. Further, if you see now, the company, we as a company, we have been pioneers in sustainable practices. Right across our 29 gardens that we operate in Assam and in Darjeeling, sustainable practices are in the forefront. Companies very, very concerned about our environmental issues and even uplifting the social standards of the millions of people who are working in the tea industry.
Right? Fantastic. On that count, I'll come to Obhijit. Obhijit, you know, being in the profession that you are, I'm very interested that, you know, it's been a long history of tea in the country, primarily from, you know, from 1894 when, you know, tea was found by this Scottish mandarin, and again, coming back to 1901 when tea production was like, at its, you know, when the railways had a huge, the Darjeeling Himalayan Railway had a huge role to play in bringing tea to the eastern part of this country. And you travel the whole world for your work. This entire culture of chai, the chai culture, like the coffee culture in the south, you know, or even in the north, there's a whole lot of coffee culture. How do you look at this dynamics of development of this chai culture in this country?
Right, so for me, tea is, you know, it's a sort of second home is India.
Okay.
And I'd almost say the first home, because it was to the rest of the world, India introduced tea to.
Right.
It wasn't China.
No.
And if you also look at the tea culture here, it's actually much more varied than China. Because in China, you have different, I mean, it's all basically the same green tea,
yes,
which is then, you know, depending on the drying, the aging, the fermentation, mm-hmm. becomes lapsang, souchong, or oolong, or white tea, or green tea,
yeah.
or black tea, what have you. But the thing is, the introduction of milk to tea, the introduction of, say, a tisane, where you add other flavorings to it, you could probably trace it back to the Kashmiri kava.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
And you look at India, the salt tea, the noon chai in Kashmir, or the gurgur tea, the butter tea of Bhutan and Ladakh, yeah, and things, yeah, like that. They're very uniquely Indian inventions. Even adding lemon, a slice of lemon to your tea.
Of course,
in India, yeah, it used to be nebu, lime, to the tea, is a very Indian thing. So I think India has so, even within India, you have so many tea cultures. Even the South, which you'd see as a coffee culture, that's a very stereotypical thing. The coffee culture is a very small urban culture. It's overwhelmingly a tea culture.
Yes, right? It is.
Yeah. So we have so many different ways of preparing the tea, which is a very different thing from the Chinese, which is different ways of fermenting and aging the tea.
Yeah.
And so India, the thing is, because of this diversity, you probably need to start having a French terroir or a Italian DOCG kind of system to start classifying and labeling these teas formally, because that is where the real value addition happens. So you have these incredible folk cultures of tea, which really need to be mainstreamed. They need to be recognized as heritage. The problem in this country is we don't recognize food and beverage as culture.
Mr. Gurung, you have a tea taster in your company. You can hire him.
He's talking about the butter tea, which, yes, you get in Bhutan, yes, and in the Tibetans, yeah, drink that tea. Mm-hmm. You'll be very surprised to note that in our country, especially if you look into the East, as we are, Abhijit is speaking about, you know, people, when they fall sick, or when they are ill, they would prefer to have tea with salt.
Tea not with salt?
Yes.
Okay.
So it's sort of a relief, you know, when you have salt and tea going in. People drink smoked teas which are fully smoked. People drink teas, like Abhijit said again, with butter, sugar, salt mixed in it. There are places where the host will not allow you to empty, he or she will keep pouring the teas, you know.
Of course, yeah.
So if your cup is half full, they will come and they'll pour it again. So there are various traditions, cultures, in our tea drinking communities in the East, apart from...
It does, and it brings me to a very interesting part of the fact that tea is almost, you know, we say my religion of love, tea is religion itself. No, to that, I'm very inquisitive to know, and from Abhijit and you, possibly you can answer as well. To begin with, Abhijit, tea has a lot of healing associated with it. It's not only the kind of healing that he's talking about, it's not just physical healing. There is a whole karmic healing that happens through tea. What do you say on that?
So, you know, the thing is, when you wake up in the morning and have that tea,
yeah,
it feels really good.
It does.
It does. That's absolutely critical, because if you look at the origins of tea, it comes from Chinese medicine, which is about making different concoctions, decocting it, and drinking the herbal essence of it.
That's right.
So it's fundamentally extremely medicinal, and it's just amazing how many antioxidants and things like that tea actually has.
Yeah.
And it blends in perfectly with your Ayurvedic culture, which you've always had in this country. Mm-hmm. Where, you know, a lot of the, I'm not going to go into the exact details of all the things, the way it's used, but my mom had certain problems, and many of the remedies that were involved in this whole process involved a lot of tea, right? So there is a healing aspect to it as well. But it's also the feeling, like umami, when you eat meat, makes you feel good. It's also this sense of well-being that you feel when you have tea.
Right.
And in that, you have two separate market categories of tea. One is the aam janta ka tea, as you want to call it, you know, which would, in say, in French or Italian wine culture, it would be the vin du table, or the vino di casa.
Yeah.
And then you have, you know, the Bordeaux and the Tuscans, the super Tuscans, and things like that.
Yeah.
And I think you need to develop each of those cultures, because there's both in, it's such a great equalizer at one level, which is also a psychological healing thing. And it's also one of those things where you can show off as well. So it can be both.
It can be a great bringer together, which is psychologically very important. I mean, you tell me, how often do you travel in, you know, dhabas and things like that, where you'll have a truck driver who gets down and has his cha, and at the same time you'll have a Mercedes S-Class or a Rolls-Royce pull up, who'll be having
possibly
the same
this
cha.
From the same place, I mean.
From the same place, yeah, from absolutely. The exact same dhaba. So it's also a great social equalizer, that.
It is. And that is such an important thing that Abhijit just pointed out. Dekhun, amra jara Bangali, amra chayer kape tufan tulte ekdom parod দর্শী ওস্তাদ কিন্তু এই কথা কিন্তু অভিজিৎ এবং বিমল মিস্টার গুরুংয়ের কথায় আমরা পাচ্ছি, বিশেষ করে অভিজিতের কথায়, যে চা শিল্প পড়ে কিন্তু চা কোথাও একটা সমতাও সৃষ্টি করছে. That comes to another you know, very interesting aspect of tea is tea is also an art form. So you know, you also use tea leaves to create art, or, you know, to paint. I know, you know, I was recently in a tea garden, of course, where I was walking down those tea trails, and I've got a very curious mind, so I went to ask one of the lady tea workers. I asked her that you're mostly you know, plucking the leaves throughout the day, do you find time for family? She said something very important, which brings me to the element of social equalizing. She says that, I earn much more than the man of the house. That was a revelation for me. I mean, revelation as in, I was so happy. This woman just said this on my face, that, you know, main to shabzi, main usse zyada kamata hoon.
So I think people tend to forget how much of a gender equalizer the tea industry has been in this country.
Do you have any observation on this, sir?
Yes. It's about 3.5 million workers associated with the tea production in India, okay, approximately. Out of this 3.5 million, you can easily take 80% of the entire workforce to be the women workforce, or the ladies, right? So you can see how important a role they play in getting your cup of tea in the morning.
Right.
Now, apart from the women, I just wanted to add, when you spoke about health, you know, in 2014 in the US, a tea company by the name of Little Me Tea started.
Little?
Me Tea, M-E. Little Meaty. Now, what they did was, this company provided tea to the children as a healthier alternative to them from drinking, say, fruit juices, which is loaded with sugars or whatever. So this Little Me Tea company came into being to introduce tea to the children, to the small children. Unfortunately, if you see in India, the younger generation, or the children, let's put it that way, below the age of maybe 12, don't have a habit of tea drinking in their households.
Excellent. Yeah.
They would rather have Horlicks or some malt-based drinks, but they don't have. So we see a lot of opportunity to promote tea as a healthier alternative to the children also, apart from adults that we drink. You know?
You wanted to add something
to
that.
Yeah, I just wanted to add something about the women tea pluckers as well. See, quality is a function of labor.
Yeah,
right?
It is.
Of labor laws and things like that. And you know, you can have the best tea plantations, but it really depends on the tea picker, you know, to have that discerning sense, and no machine can do it, to see if that particular blossom or bud, whatever you call it, is ready to pluck at that particular point of time and plucks it perfectly. Because you can have the best plantations, you're still not going to get that tea unless the trained person plucking it knows their job. So that is your single point of quality control, which is one of the very interesting things about the tea industry, where you can actually do grassroots human value addition, which is socially such an important thing. And I myself have seen, though I haven't seen the Darjeeling tea estates, I have seen in Nilgiris how many stories of liberation. In a sense, you know what Grameen Bank did for women in Bangladesh? The tea industry has in fact achieved a lot of that in terms of not microcredit, but actual micropayments to people.
Yeah.
And value addition for women in India, especially rural women. That's a very, very important part of it. Second, I agree, the tea culture among kids has gone. But when I was growing up, kids did not have coffee. The standard line was, bachara coffee khayena. Right? So it was always, tea was perfectly okay. You were always given tea. Tea was good. I think even now in rural areas when you go there, the kids still have a tea culture. For them, it's kind of, it's the big grown-up thing that we can do.
Right.
And I still see a lot of hope in rural India and non-urban India for that younger tea generation. But I think for the urban tea generation, we've got to make tea cool again or make tea great again.
I think that's a very important point, Mr. Gurung. You know, in this panel discussion of Earth, we are talking about the entire chai culture of East India. How do you think having, like, coffee, like when you go out on a date, you say, let's go out for a cup of coffee. You don't say, let's go out for a cup of tea. The way we would say that, let's go for a drink, maybe. How do you look at it from the branding point of view? Tea being a cool drink.
Yeah, of course, it is. Like you said, people go to the bars to have a drink. They go to coffee cafes to have coffee. And if you look into our company, we have also diversified in the sense that we now have tea lounges all across. We have 5-6 of them all across India. So what the company is basically trying to do is let the people enjoy their cup of tea. You know, most of the teas, the better quality teas or the best quality teas used to be normally exported or still is being exported. Normal people didn't have access to drinking or experiencing this type of tea. The really top quality specialty teas that sells for 30,000, 40,000 rupees a kilo. But today, if you can go to, say, Margaret's Deck, you don't need to buy 250 grams. You can experience that top quality tea in a single cup.
Yes, true. You've made it available for people.
Of course. So everybody has now access to drinking the best of tea, and that is where our tea lounges come. You come to the tea lounges, you experience the best of teas, make tea drinking an enjoyable experience, you know.
Yes, I see that. Of course, I enjoy my tea. I'm a true blue Bengali. But that's not the point. The point is, you know, Abhijit, we are gradually moving to the end of this discussion. What intrigues me is the ayyar in the mitra, you know, the ayyar, the way he was just saying that how you used to long to go to Madras and you don't want to go to Madras, which is a different thing altogether. Sorry, Chennai. But you grew up in Chennai, which is essentially predominantly a cafe culture. So, I mean, I don't want to use that as a slang. I'm just saying, and kapi is, built a kapi is like, you know, it's single malt for them. So, you know, a lot of my Bengali friends say, amake filter coffee na dile ami khabo na. Amar baba filter coffee kete bishon bhalo bashten. Onno oishob cappuccino tappuccino kichu jantam na tokhon ar ki. So, you know, how do you look at this religion? How do you look at this culture where coffee is predominant but tea is taking a back seat, where you've grown up? How do you look at that?
So for me, it was always a sort of mixed culture, because having a Bengali father was very much a tea culture.
Okay.
And having a Tam Bram mother was very much a coffee culture.
Yes, of course.
But the thing was, that even the tea culture in our house,
yeah.
Today, for example, if you come over, I've got my roaster in Madras who couriers over the correct blend of 80% Arabica and 20% chicory, sends it over, and it has to be made the correct way. But I also follow that routine with tea. I've got more teas in my cupboard. I've got about 16, 20 varieties of tea. And one of the favorite things that I do, but see, my usage of tea is also very different. I find increasingly my guests, when I offer them, say, a macchiato or a espresso, mm-hmm. Or a tea in the evening, when they want it to be light, they will always go in for a tea. So much of it also depends on what you cook in the evening for them.
Right.
On yes. how heavy they're feeling.
Mm-hmm.
So if I stuff them up, they'd any day prefer a tea over a coffee. And the second thing is, I use my teas not just as a beverage, but some of the finer teas, for example. Mm. One of my favorite teas is, and I'm so glad I've met you here, but is the Goodrick Muscatel.
The Muscatel.
And my favorite thing to do with that is to make a sorbet.
Serve
my guests after dinner.
Wow.
Right. Other sorbets that I make are the rose oolong. I mix it with lychee juice and more tea.
I'm coming to Delhi next month.
You are. So you try all of these things.
Okay.
But, you know, there is so much. We tend... coffee has become almost a stock standard in any ice cream repertoire.
Right.
Tea hasn't. And tea is a much more exquisite, much more diverse flavor.
Wow. Yeah.
When you're looking at experimentative cuisine and, you know, pushing the edges of cooking, just pushing the edges of flavor, because it requires absolutely nothing. Coffee, filter coffee needs to have chicory. Tea doesn't need to have everything. Because in terms, if I were to equate this to, say, caviar.
Yeah, yeah.
India is the absolute beluga, Caspian beluga caviar of teas.
Absolutely.
But
absolutely.
India is not the Caspian beluga caviar of coffees.
No, it is not. Right. And in fact, today desserts, like a green tea ice cream or a flavor, is so fascinating to know that, you know, even ice creams have green tea. Like the naturals, when you go out to a naturals outlet, you would see that you buy an ice cream which is a green tea flavor, which is amazing.
And I wonder why they don't just make a muscatel tea. Because
of course
it needs nothing. A muscatel ice cream.
Ice cream,
because
yes.
It needs nothing. The tea itself is so beautiful that when you've got the correct consistency of the ice, the way it melts in your mouth, the way all those flavonoids and the tannins and everything spread is just, it's like tasting a truly great European wine that would easily set you back about, say, 400-500 euros a bottle.
Absolutely.
Right, because even that match of tannins and things like that is an art. And it depends also on your tea culture of how you brew the water. You can't oxidize it too much and things like that. It'll develop. I think more.
I know. You're right. You know. Mr. Gurung, we're just about 5 minutes or 4 minutes left for the discussion. You know, as children, we used to read these famous tea parties in novels and English novellas or short stories. It's so fascinating that, you know, especially if you read a Charles Dickens, you would definitely, like, you know how Miss Havisham used to throw tea parties, you know. It used to be a sign of, opulence to a lot of people. You know, I really think that the culture of tea has to be more adaptive, keeping in mind the taste and the opportunities and the awareness that the youth has today. Abhijit is probably one of the few who I meet is a connoisseur, not only a connoisseur, who has such a huge knowledge of what tea he wants and the kinds of tea he does. But as a company, I like you to close the session with a little more insight into Goodrick's plans, future plans of probably adapting the tea culture more into the country. What are your plans for the company?
Yeah, of course. One needs to adjust. We need to keep adapting with changing times. Because if you see earlier, tea companies used to make just black tea, right?
Yes.
Then slowly we progressed into making green tea. So it became black tea, green tea, then we graduated into making white teas, specialty teas. We now have purple tea. It's absolutely purple in color. You have yellow teas. We have instant teas. We have ready-to-drink RTDs. So our company has progressed also in the same way. We make all these teas now. We have to adjust. From those days when the tea leaf fell into a Chinese emperor's bowl of water,
yes.
We have progressed to tea being served in a tablet form.
Absolutely.
So along with changing times, the company is that way, very, very progressive. You know, we need to keep adjusting. So we now also run an instant tea plant where we make instant tea. So we make black tea, green tea, white tea, specialty teas, yellow teas, purple teas, RTDs. We have our own branded tea division, which gives all these teas to the people around here.
Absolutely.
And that's of course, the most important thing with the changing times is that people, like you said, people are becoming more aware. They are not only becoming more aware, like Abhijit is, of the quality of tea, but also of the safety aspect.
Yes, of course.
How safe and how hygienically is the tea that you drink made? A company gives top priority not only to the quality, like I said, but also to the safety aspects.
Absolutely.
So this is the way
absolutely.
You progress.
Well, on that note, we come to the end of this lovely discussion. I must thank Abhijit and Mr. Gurung for their time. And Earth, as you know, is a culture quest and a culture fest, which digs into the field of civilization, history, art, culture, and like an excavator, it finds out the elements that binds us, and tea is definitely one of them. Tea is a very important element in the culture mix of us, of India, of the Indic thought. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being with us. I hope you continue to watch us live on the Facebook and YouTube page of Z Chobish Ghanta and the Facebook page of Earth, a Culture Fest. Thank you very much. See you in the next panel very soon. Thank you, Abhijit. Thank you, Mr. Guru. Thank you. Culture, culture. Culture, culture.